SPF 72 is.
That's a true story.
Okay, welcome everyone. I'm so happy that you are here. This is the conference on near-death experiences while drowning. We have some very special people in this room. So spiritually thinking, this museum will fly in a few seconds. We're going to have a variation of presentations that will make a nice blend of experiences and knowledge exchange. After a little while, you will have the opportunity to give and share with us your experiences about what you just heard, ask potential questions, as well as tell us what you think about the whole event. Please switch off your telephones if you haven't done so. Some ladies here were very kind to do it from the beginning. And before we start, I would like to make an introduction that our ambassador for the conference has made. So Bob Burnside could not make it to come here because he lives in Utah. He's one of the most iconic figures in the United States. He's the founder of the United States Life Saving Association. And you probably know that in the television series Baywatch, there was the rescue can. He's the creator. So his equipment has helped so much the lifeguards improve their jobs, because in the past they were using a rope. They were raping actually their shoulder, and then the next day they had to use the next shoulder. They were very injured all the time until he invented that. So he has said that the near-death experience is a paranormal phenomenon that should merit attention from all of us. It's something neglected so far from the aquatic safety industry, aquatic safety professionals, every other profession that involves aquatics and emergency. So it's something that we should really pay attention, because it involves 1 million people that survive drowning per year on Earth. And on the top of that, you can count how many people survive from heart attacks, from any other causes of death. So it's really, really important. And he is acknowledging the fact that the International Swimming Hall of Fame is hosting this event. So after that, I will have the joy to welcome the President and CEO of the National Swimming Hall of Fame, Bruce Weigo, to give his thoughts about this event.
Music all there, clapping. So how we do this when the music is there? Usually it's the man who needs no introduction, and then I don't get one. Sadly. Well, really, Stathy has done an incredible job. When he first proposed this, I said, we need to schedule a successful event. We need a year, 18 months to really organize it. But things start small. So when you look at a lot of the great conferences, they start small. And I think this has the potential to be something very successful and much larger as we go along. My interest in drowning, besides being a lifeguard over the years and as a kid, doing a lot of rescues and CPR with heart attacks on the beach and all this in Ocean City, New Jersey, which is, if you look up there, one of our former presidents, Jack Kelly, and that's Princess Grace is in that. That's where I was a lifeguard in Ocean City, New Jersey. But my lifeguarding skills came in pretty handy in 1999. I have a son that was a three-time Olympian, but he was a 1996 Olympian in water polo. And he was playing in the backyard pool with my younger children and their friends, and they decided to have a little contest to see if the kids could do a relay underwater and my older son could match them. So they did, 12, 15 laps or something like that combined, and every time he'd get ready to go in his turn, they'd say something, he'd just laugh his head off, and he'd take a couple deep breaths, ha ha ha, laugh, he couldn't start, and he ended up taking off super hyperventilated. So I'm there on the side of the pool and I hear this thing, "Dad, Wolfie's pretending to drown in the backyard pool," and they're down there kicking him and taking his goggles off and didn't recognize it. And you know, immediately recognized that there was a problem, jumped in, pulled him out, and he was blue with eyes glazed and weighed a ton. I mean, he was a 205-pound Olympic athlete. And got him out of the pool and flipped him over and got some water out of him and then gave him CPR and brought him back to life. And his experience in telling me was somewhat similar to you know, what we've always heard about what happens when you have a near-death experience. Although it's not quite like the white light, but everything kind of got bright, and he remembered the kids coming down and, you know, hacking them, but he never had any sense of burning lung to come up to breathe, because that was the trick of the physiology of hyperventilation. So this was just a super incredible experience about this, and I wrote pretty extensively about it at the time. And of course, that's all gone now, even off the internet, it's tough to find. But that was the real first experience of dealing with someone really close to it, and in an instant, in a beautiful day in a backyard pool, you know, having the time of the life, the kids all happy and everything, and turning an instant into tragedy and drowning in the most least likely of places. My backyard pool, president of the International, I was the CEO of USA Water Polo at the time. And party atmosphere, and instantly to something that could have been incredibly tragic. And drowning is an incredible issue, and it's not just people that don't know how to swim. I mean, here's a kid that's in, you know, one of the best watermen in the world. And not just, you know, in a pool. I mean, he's an absolute waterman and could have drowned. And we see this with other instances too. Fran Crippen, world-class swimmer, drowning in a FINA-sanctioned open water race. Mm-hmm. So, and then it's the near-death experience, which I think is really phenomenal. And I remember back in college in the 60s, but reading Cooper Ross about it back in those days, about this phenomenon that seems to be repetitive. And my son didn't have exactly like that, but he kind of, everything was kind of a dream sequence, so who knows where he was, and maybe he wasn't that close to being really dead. So, I think this is a great conference. I think it's a great thing. And Stathy, all the credit to you for putting this together and kind of on a very short timeline, and for all of you for coming and taking an interest in what we're doing here. So with that, I'll let you get down to your business, and I'll get back to my work. I don't know if you're aware, if you're in the area, we have our induction ceremony next Saturday night, and we're also going to have one of the more incredible photo exhibits of the history of swimming through the photographic lens that's going to be up there, and we have contributions from the great photographers past and present, and it's really been an incredible experience of hearing about the cooperative collaboration between photographers who are incredibly competitive with each other, yet sharing their secrets to develop what we now take for granted in the world of underwater photography. And really, one of the great guys was who was obsessed with getting pictures underwater. I don't know if you know the split shots now, that, you know, you're seeing underwater and above water. Well, there's a lot of physics and math involved in making that happen, because water magnifies pictures and the exposures are different. And this guy that dedicated his life to this in the 1950s said that, because nobody took pictures of swimmers underwater at that point in time, was that when you see swimmers from just about every camera angle, it's just a bunch of splashing and you see an arm and it, you know, but if you wanted to really see swimming, you had to go underwater. And now when you see the pictures from the Olympic Games, like the Michael Phelps touch there, that, you know, you see the truth about swimming is from underwater. So with that, I'll turn the program back over to Stathy, and you know, wish you guys the best of luck, and I hope that the next time we have this, we have, you know, two or three times this, and then perhaps in a few years we'll have hundreds. So thanks again for coming and supporting this. And when you take a break, if you haven't been to the Hall of Fame before, this is the most incredible archive and collection of swimming memorabilia anywhere in the world. You go to the IOC Museum over in Lausanne, Switzerland. And I mean, anything related to swimming and aquatics. And they've got like 60 other sports or something that they do, but we have all the stuff. So, all right. Good luck.
At the end, wait for the presentation ceremony. That's a big speech.
I'll be. You know where to find me.
All right, and after this welcoming reception from Bruce, I will invite our next speaker, who is Audrey Dalton, a near-death experiencer, who will tell us how this phenomenon changed her life.
This is the first time, by the way, that I've ever spoken publicly about my near-death experience to a group of people. So bear with me. Stathy, which ones enter? The plus or the?
The buttons are not Greek.
I've never seen a laptop like this. Is it the? Which one? Oh, yeah. Okay. So, I am an artist. I am happy to be here, happy to see all of you. I wanted to thank my husband publicly, John, because he encouraged me to do this. I wanted to thank Stathy, who kind of roped me into this in the nicest possible way. And I wanted to thank Jen for all the work she's done on near-death experiences, because it's life-changing. I was born very healthy, very happy, as you can see. And I grew up on Long Island, New York, with a very close family. That's my mother, Shirley, on the left here, and me and my brother on the right. And if you look at both of them, they are in close proximity to me because, as a happy, healthy child, I was a runner. So they knew better than to have let go of my hand at any juncture in time in a public place. And that's my dad, Noel, who had fought in World War II. I think I'm about a year old here. And my dad was always my hero. He actually became my hero in real life. And always affectionate, both parents, very affectionate grandparents. That's my brother feeding me, younger here. Should have put these in proper juxtaposition. Mm-hmm. And that's my grandfather, my dad's dad, holding me, and my grandmother, Navy, done. Now that bears into the storyline here for the near-death experience. Now, as a family, growing up, two of our favorite things to do were to go to the beach, and the other was to go to my grandparents' homes. One lived in the lowest part of New Jersey, one lived in the highest part of New Jersey, and the highest part was Highland Lakes, New Jersey. And my dad's dad lived right on the lake, on Highland Lake. I did not know how to swim. My brother knew how to swim, but my parents considered me too young at that age. I was, you know, from the age of 1 to 5. I might have been around the water, but I never would have had swimming lessons. Anyway, that is actually my grandparents' house. And if you look at the lower left photograph, that is a photo of the rock that slipped and fell. Water, which is adjacent to their home. Now, every year at Highland Lakes, because of it being filled with lots of wildlife, it's also a man-made lake, they would purge the water, and they put an anti-algae product into it. But that product would float to the edges of the lake, cover the rocks, making them horribly slippery. My grandfather died on August 2nd, 1961. My dad was super close to his father, so his death was very sad in our family. I have really bad timing. The day of my grandfather's funeral, which was August 5th, I had my drowning accident. And it wasn't an accident, it was an incident, because accidents are accidental. These are incidents, and there is a big difference in the drowning community to know the difference. Anyway, my grandfather, as you know, lived in Highland Lake, so my dad piled us all in the car to go up to the funeral. And the day of the funeral was sunny and beautiful. And after the funeral, the reception was held at my grandparents' house. So my mother, knowing kids would want to be outside at some point, changed me into a white shirt and white shorts. And I remember that because it feeds into my story. Now, this is actually a segment of my dad's diary. I came upon it when he died, which was about 7 years ago. And when I read it, I burst into tears because he talks about my incident. And he says it's a day the tragedy struck. Now, for him, to me, I would have thought the tragedy would be losing his father, which that was a tragedy. But what happened was, here in the midst of this commemorative event, the lady next door had two teenage sons, and she was going to feed them lunch. She was also at the reception. She said, "Look, I'm going to feed my sons. Your kids need to eat. Why don't you let them come over and have lunch?" My brother wanted to go fishing off the dock. So he went fishing off the dock. And my mother, after much persuasion, because she knew that I was a runner, she said, "Okay, but keep an eye on her like a hawk." So I went next door and had lunch. And about halfway through the lunch, the eldest of the two teenage sons, Roger, gets up and says, "I'm going for a swim." Takes off. And I'm left there with the younger of the two, Skip, and his mom. And then sooner or later, Skip says, "I'm going for a swim." Skip takes off after Roger. I'm alone with mom. Time passes, 5, 10 minutes, the mother says, "Do you mind going outside and just taking a look and seeing if you see them?" She didn't ask if I knew how to swim. She didn't know if I knew how to swim. I don't blame her for asking that question, because blame doesn't have any place in this. So I went outside and went towards the lake. I stood on the rock. I don't think I was there 5 seconds when I hit that slippery algae, slipped, hit the back of my head, and I'll tell you, I had a lump in the back of my cranium for years after that event. The next thing I know, of course, I passed out momentarily because I was knocked out. So even if I knew how to swim, it wouldn't have mattered. Now, this is a factor that feeds into drowning, period, because oftentimes people will dive into a pool that's too shallow, hit their head, that's it. They could be that world's best swimmer. So it's important to know the depth of things that you're going into their bodies of water. In any event, when I came to, I was underwater. And as a child, having never been submerged in water, my little brain said, "Open your mouth and breathe." I opened my mouth, I got a mouthful of water. Now, for anybody who doesn't know, drowning is slow suffocation. And you have no idea the empathy I feel for parents who lose their children to drowning. It tears my heart out. And I used to question why I'm still here and other people aren't. But I think we all have a purpose, whether it's here or in the next plane. And I do believe there's a next plane. So, anyway, as I'm slowly suffocating, something my daddy said to me came in my head. He said, "If you're ever afraid, put your hands together and pray God will take care of you." And here I was, I didn't know how to swim, so I prayed. With that, I flew out of my body, and I observed myself. All the terror I was experiencing left, all the fear left, all the angst of not being able to, the suffocation left. And at some juncture, I felt hands underneath me lifting me up. It was Skip treading water, holding me above his head, screaming at the top of his lungs, "She's drowned! Help me, she's drowned!" Well, of course, there were people right next door, so they heard it. My brother, poor guy, he heard it. He was only 5 and a half years old, older than me. So, or 4 and a half, I've forgotten which. Anyway, he could tell you something. But he heard it. He knew course, looking at me, it's his little sister. So, first person I saw all this happening, first person once I was deposited on the rock that came was the lifeguard, who was right down the beach. She said, I'm a lifeguard, let me take care of her. She tries to revive me. And no success. Next voice I hear is my Uncle Jeff. And he said, let me have her, let me try. And he tried, at that point in time, this was 1961, he tried the whacking on the back, which Bruce Weigel explains you're getting water out of the lungs. That didn't work. And the next thing I hear is my dad's voice. And he says, give her to me. And then he looks at me and he says, please God, not another one. And he kneels down and he gives me CPR. Now this is interesting. The conjunction of timelines will help things happen. My dad was in World War II, but he stayed in the reserves afterwards. And he had gone and taken lessons in CPR, but just then they were using mouth to mouth. So two gentlemen had thought of that process and had introduced it to the military. So my dad knew it. So that's the first thing he did. I remember feeling, it was the oddest thing. I was out of my body, but in my body at the same time. I was watching it, but feeling it. I could feel him pressing on my chest. I could feel him breathing into me and constantly saying, breathe, baby, breathe. And then finally I heard him say, she's breathing. And almost simultaneously, I hear the sound of a siren. It's the ambulance. So this is the detailing of the advent of mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. It was Peter Safer and James Ely that thought up that method. Now, nowadays, of course, they've changed it once again as to what methodology you should use in combination with or by itself. And anyway, the closest hospital to where we were was in Warwick, New Jersey. Now, if you look at this picture, that shows Breakneck Road, which literally was given the name because you can tend to break your neck on it because it's a two-lane highway that goes at almost a 90-degree angle straight down to Warwick, New York. That's where the closest hospital was, St. Anthony's Hospital. So I get loaded in the ambulance. My parents climb in. There's an EMT technician in the ambulance in the back. There's an ambulance driver in front. And I hear my brother say, and I could see him standing with maybe my grandmother with her arm around him. And she's saying, no, honey, you can't go. He's saying, but I have to be with her. And so, you know, it's like your mind records these things. Anyway, so we're in the ambulance and we're bouncing back and forth because the road winds horribly. My mother lost a ring, a diamond in her ring because she bounced so violently. And years later, my dad replaced it. Anyway, so I'm vomiting blood the whole way there. Now, a lot of people may not associate that with drowning, but apparently, looking back in time and talking to physicians, my lungs had filled so much. There's a technical term for divers where your lungs burst. That's what happened. So St. Anthony's Hospital was started by the Franciscan Sisters of the Poor. And many, if not all, the nurses in the hospital at that time were nuns. And they wore the very traditional garb. So, yes, Stathis.
Speak a little bit more louder, please.
Oh, okay. Anyway, a lot of these sisters were nuns, if not all, in the hospital. And when I arrived at the hospital, I could see them taking me out of the ambulance. Could see my father and my mother crying because somewhere before we arrived at the hospital, the ambulance driver said she's DOA, radioed it into the hospital. My mother said, what's that mean? She didn't know what the acronym meant. And my dad said, dead on arrival. And of course, she's crying the whole time anyway, so she was very concerned. So we get out of the ambulance. They take me into the hospital to the emergency room. And I see the ambulance driver throwing up and crying hysterically. And my dad said, you did everything you could. He said, no, you don't understand. I had a drowning incident myself as a child. And so that was me in the back. So they get me into the emergency room. Oh, by the way, one of the nurses was Sister Rose Margaret, who was a little child, somehow I deciphered was Margaret Rose. And she's pictured right there on the far end. And she stayed at that hospital for years, ended up writing a book about her work there. Had I known that, I would have run for the book, but I only discovered it after the fact. And to me, that would be very fascinating to get a hold of that. Anyway, so I'm in the emergency room, and I'm watching myself from the ceiling. And then all of a sudden, I'm in another room, and I see my parents sitting on a bench, hugging one another and crying. And I was able to identify the space visually. And then I'm back in the emergency room, and I hear one of the nurses say, "It's too late, doctor. We might as well stop. She's gone." And he said, "I'm not letting a five-year-old girl die on my watch." Now, he was a young man, because I can still see him. Light brown hair, probably in his 30s. And they prepared this humongous needle. And as a little child, I'm thinking, what's that for? Anyway, I remember they cut away my shirt. And I remember it was brand new. To me, as a child, that was a big deal. And I thought, Mommy's going to be mad they cut my shirt. Well, next thing I see is the needle going towards my chest. And then I felt, that hurts. And he got my heart beating. And I flew back into my body. And the Sister Rose Margaret said, "Doctor, do you mind if I say prayers as we take her up in the elevator to the intensive care unit?" He said, "Absolutely, you go ahead." So she was alone in the elevator with me and said prayers the whole time. And if I ever doubted the power of prayer at any time in my life, I just go back to that moment in time. Anyway, I was in a deep coma, and there is a scale for comas in this day and age. Well, I was in the deepest form of a coma. The doctors told my parents, and I actually overheard them saying, "If she wakes up, she won't know who you are. She won't be able to speak. She won't be able to walk. She will have no movement. She will be a vegetable for the rest of her life. You need to prepare yourself." Well, in actuality, during that time I was coma, not only did I hear everything that went on, I described the people who came and went from my room. And the one person who never came in was my brother. I remember thinking as a little girl, why isn't he here? What I didn't know is he was kept from going in. It was hospital rules at the time. So, Sister Rose Margaret came and visited me. The priest came and said prayers. They had prayers piped through the room behind a painting. I knew each technician by voice when they would come in and change my clothes, etc., during that 10-day period. And most especially, I identified my parents coming in every day. And one day, my dad was missing. I thought, where's Daddy? Because they always came in together. Well, I found out years later that my dad had gotten in the car and driven 3 hours to our house on Long Island to get me my favorite teddy bear. Mm-hmm. So it would be there when I woke up. Well, he said he walked into my room and just collapsed on his knees because that room represented me, which was always full of life. Well, one day while I was in a coma, another incident that I recounted to my parents, that they were like, how did you know that? My mother was saying she's not breathing, and she was crying to the doctor. The doctor said, "Do you have a compact?" She said, "Yes." He said, "Pull it out of your purse, put it under her nose." And she did, and she saw the breath in the mirror. And she said, "Oh, thank you, God." And she's crying, and I felt the tear on my cheek, and I thought, "Don't cry, Mommy, I'm here. I'm here." So, anyway, after 10 days, simultaneously I woke up out of the coma, and the first person I asked for was my brother. Well, he had come to the hospital every single time, because of course my parents didn't want to leave him with my grandmother, who was grieving, and had people coming and going all the time. And I asked for my brother. He came running in. Two of us are hugging and crying. My parents are hugging and crying. the doctors are crying. And then I asked for Sister Rose Margaret, and I called her Margaret Rose, and she came and she said, how did you know my name? I said, you said prayers for me. And she said, how did you know that? I said, I heard every word. So, I'm not saying that there was glory in a near-death experience. It was both terrifying, not good at timing, and certainly I would never ever wish to anyone to live through a drowning experience or to experience a drowning experience. I hadn't heard Bruce talk about his son until just today, and that really got me deeply because that's a horrible thing for a parent to feel. Anyway, I had 7 years of doctor's visits almost every single weekend because I was left with an irregular heartbeat. I overheated terribly easily because of any stress to my heart would make my body overheat. I was kept from exercise for 7 years, so by the time I could exercise, I went to the opposite extreme and went nuts for it. So I also had night terrors, which if you've never heard of them, they are usually due to a very traumatic experience, and I would wake up screaming night after night, which would no doubt add to a parent's distress. I had severe anxiety attacks, which I never pinpointed till I was an adult. I still have them, and they're unexpected, which I'll tell you about one of them in a minute. And I used to sleepwalk as a result, which again is usually due to traumatic instances. But the after effects I was left with were very strange, especially to a child. I was prescient from a little child from that moment on. I was able to see things before they happened. I was able to predict things that before they happened. To this day, I'll see a whole day before it occurs, and darn if it doesn't occur exactly the way I saw it. I have a very strong sense of telepathy. I pick up on people's thoughts before they open their mouths, which my husband says is really annoying. And I tend to say it before he says it. I have no fear of death whatsoever. I have a tremendous respect for the power of water. I made it my goal in life to go after and talk about my experience, but from a little child, I was made fun of for it, even by adults. So I stopped talking about it, which I was telling to Jan earlier. But the things that I took away in terms of the most profound is that I do know that our soul survives beyond death, definitely. And that's been a comfort to many of the people I've spoken to through my lifetime. So the other thing I was determined to do was swim. And I had this horrendous fear of water. My parents put me through swim lessons for 10 years at least. And my brother tried teaching me, my mother tried teaching me, so finally my mother said, look, why don't you have some therapy? So I went for psychiatric hypnotherapy, which got to the root cause of my fear, which was slipping and falling in water. The other thing was putting my face in water. I couldn't do it. I never even took a shower with my face facing the water until I learned to swim. And one day I realized, oh my goodness, this is an after learning to swim experience. So in any event, I finally learned to swim with the help of a psychologist. It took me 4 months to swim half a lap. One day, one of the swim coach's daughters shows up at the pool, and she's like, what are you doing standing in the middle of the pool? I said, I'm trying to get to the deep end. She said, I'll tell you what, I'll walk alongside you while you do. But you'll see me. Every breath you take, you'll see me. So she did. Darn if I didn't see her. I got to the deep end. I was like, that's cool. So she said, I'll walk you through all the rest of the laps you want to do. And I did a mile, which in an Olympic-sized pool is about 68 laps. I was telling Jan before, when you get out after doing something that is your greatest fear, I felt like I was Rocky. Dun, dun. But I also, thereafter, swam a mile every day. And since I learned to swim at the age of 27, I have swam from the east coast of the United States to the west coast of the United States, back again, and more, 11,900 miles plus. So that's what I kind of think. Yeah. I was very impressed with that. Anyway, I've become spokesperson for drowning prevention. I worked for a drowning prevention nonprofit for about 5 years. And I would tell anyone who is a lifesaver, who is in the life-saving industry, who teaches aquatics, never ever think that a victim that you've pulled from the water is automatically not going to hear you. They hear you. I've spoken to other people who have been seemingly unconscious, and I would say more than half hear every word you say. So it's important that you're encouraging to that person. Tell them you're there. Tell them you're going to take care of them. I'm also passionate for swimming lessons, obviously, in all facets of water safety, and for all ages. You'd be surprised how many adults in the United States alone do not know how to swim. They might know how to float, but they have no idea of how to swim or be above the water. In any event, I've obviously had a blessed life. I met my husband John when he was a lifeguard. And my mother had teased me growing up saying, you should marry a lifeguard. But he was going to school at the time, and his dad had met him before me and said, I got the perfect son for you. And when my husband got back from the Marine Corps, he asked me out for 6 months before I said yes. And we've been together 25 years and married for 23. He is my rock. He is a wonderful man. He has encouraged me to do everything I've done. Every goal I've wanted to reach, he's the best. So I've had 30 plus years as a fine artist. Those are some of my portraits. As a muralist. And I've done public works of art, which have hung in museums. And then I segued into marketing and advertising because I wanted to promote water safety. So I did that for the City of Broward, which is a water watcher tag. Lots of you who teach aquatics are probably familiar with water watchers. And there's a program that started in Broward called Water Smart Babies. And so I made that cover for that little booklet. And I've remained close to my family the whole time. My brother and I still talk every week. I just saw him fairly recently. He has a family of four, a lot of kids, all of who know how to swim. And he's a water bug himself, my brother always was. And through my work with the drowning prevention organization, they had a conference here at ISHOF. Now you gotta understand, this is the girl who wanted to swim her whole life. And I ended up at the International Swimming Hall of Fame. I was like totally starstruck walking through here. And I got to work here for a couple times with the person who ran that organization at the time. And I met through one of their conferences this woman named Shauna Ladio. Now Shauna Ladio is a petite woman in size, but her heart and her courage exceed most people I know of both sexes. She is dedicated to water safety and drowning prevention. And we stayed friends from that moment on, even though she lives in California and I live here. So during that time, I went back to school and studied nonprofit leadership and management. And I wanted to be the head of an organization that had to do with water safety. This has been my goal. And there are a lot of organizations out there that are focused entirely on drowning prevention, but mostly on swimming pools. Well, it's a big world. Every continent is surrounded by water. And I realized there's a part of drowning prevention that's neglected, and it has to do with being on open bodies of water. Well, Sean's business was teaching personal watercraft to lifesavers, to boating law enforcement, and to the military. So somewhere along the line, her business got too large, and I said, well, why don't we pair up? And she said, yeah, let's pair up. So here I am, and I'm working with her. And that's her. She was on the cover of Reader's Digest, and that's a personal watercraft. They're wider than a regular jet ski, although she operates both. And she's the founder and CEO of Rescue Watercraft Association. Now, during my conversations with her, I said, Sean, you've got this organization, isn't it, nonprofit? Oh, I never went through the process. I said, hello, you have me. So I incorporated, and we are now officially a nonprofit. We are qualified for fundraising in the state of Florida, and we're going to get qualified for fundraising in, I hope, the rest of the United States at some juncture. It takes a lot of money. And we're in the process of applying for our 501c3 determination. And I'm the executive director. Mm-hmm. And I'm proud to be the executive director because obviously this is a passion of mine. But what a lot of people don't know about drowning is, according to the World Health Organization, it's a pandemic, which means it's gone beyond epidemic stage. If you go to the CDC, there's a search engine called WISQARS, WISQARS, I think is how it's spelled. It's an acronym. If you go in there, you can drill down statistics by race, by age, by demographics in the United States. Now, you have to understand, every public health organization in the United States gathers this data over a period of time, but it has to be inputted. So usually the CDC's most recent information is from a year or two prior to the current year. But that said, in 2015, 360,000 people died from drowning around the world. And in the United States, it is number six out of all unintentional injuries. The worst statistic is the age of 1 to 5. So my positive experiences from my near-death experience is I got all these extraordinary gifts as a result that I did not have prior to. My parents knew I was precocious ahead of time, but being prepared to lose all of that, they were quite surprised when I ended up in gifted classes. In college, I was on the Honor Society, so my experience did not affect my intellect, it just affected my physical abilities for a while. Like I said, I have a respect for the power of water. I want to make sure that I publicly address drowning as often as possible, and that water safety and swim instruction are vital for from babies on up. If a pediatrician says your baby can take swim lessons, let them take swim lessons with a qualified instructor. I wanted to grow a nonprofit, which I made that wish come true. And I wanted to help other people. I've always wanted to help other people. And I'm extremely thankful for life. And I said to Stathis before this event that I have very prescient moments. Well, I also have very serendipitous moments in my life. And I had spoken to Julia Leo via email. And here she walks through the door. So tell me that's not just a little strange.
Are we ready?
Yes.
So now I have the pleasure to welcome my wonderful friend and colleague, Professor John Holden from University of North Texas, whose modesty knows no bounds. So I'm going to tell a few things about her because she will never tell for herself. She is one of the 10 most important people in the world in the near-death experience phenomenon, if not in a closer scale. And she has been the president of the International Association for Near-Death Studies, as well as the chief editor of the single journal scientific magazine, Journal of Near-Death Studies. So her life is dedicated to the phenomenon, and it's really, really a privilege and great joy to have her among us, because this is not happening very often. So I would like to welcome her.
Okay, I've never been introduced like this before. I want to thank you, Stathis, for this invitation, and it's such a delight to meet Audrey finally. After Stathis and I worked on the Drowning Near-Death Experience book, to actually hear your story in person after having read it several times. It was really wonderful. And so it's my pleasure to talk with you today, and I think we're going to do a little technological switch now. So Stathy's going to come and switch out my computer. The reason is that I have excerpts from an interview with a near-death experiencer that I use my outside voice, even though we're inside. Okay, so so here we are, and as I said, I'm a professor of counseling and chair of the Department of Counseling and Higher Education at the University of North Texas in Denton, which is in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. And so I'm going to start by telling you a little bit about the field of near-death studies. Some of you may have read, how many of you have read Raymond Moody's book, Life After Life? Audrey has, that would make sense. But Raymond Moody is a psychiatrist and philosopher who really formally opened the field of near-death studies in 1975 with his book, Life After Life. And in it, he described over 100 cases of people who had survived a close brush with death and remembered something unusual. They didn't just blank out when they were in the first throes of death. They actually remembered something very vivid, like what Audrey described to us. And so one of the first things he said in the book, however, was that these experiences have existed in throughout cultures and across time, throughout history. He cited ancient Egyptian, Tibetan, Greek, and Christian texts as citing examples of near-death experiences. So this is not new. And in fact, these experiences had been written about in the professional literature, but because they didn't really have a name, they kind of hadn't gotten focused attention. Now that it's in his book that the term near-death experience was coined and the acronym NDE, and once the phenomenon got named, a focus coalesced around the phenomenon, and since then there's been a lot of study, which I'll tell you about, well, actually right now. By 2005, which is the last time that we counted, over 700 journal articles have been written about NDEs, 65 research studies, and these involved studies in the US, Europe, Asia, and Australia at that time, involving more than 3,500 near-death experiencers and studying both the experience and its after effects. And of course, since then, even more has been published. So this presentation is going to include the material from 2005, which is in the Handbook of Near-Death Experiences, for which I was lead editor, plus everything that's happened since then. So it's updated. So we know now that NDEs occur most often during serious illness or injury, but actually that's not the only time they occur. Experiences that are indistinguishable from near-death experiences occur in a variety of circumstances, and in my thinking, the circumstances involve extremes. So when a person is obviously extremely ill or near death, that's a really good facilitator for this type of experience. But people describe these experiences when they've been extremely peaceful, as in meditation, or back in their backyard hot tub, resting alone, looking up at the stars, and suddenly having what we now call a near-death-like experience. It really is indistinguishable from an NDE. People have them in the extremes of exertion. People sometimes talk about these kind of experiences when they've run like 20K races. They have them in the extremes of emotion, sometimes in grief. People have spontaneous NDE-like experiences. I even heard one man talk about a situation he was arguing vehemently in a vehement argument with his girlfriend, and he was just absolutely overwhelmed with jealousy, and he suddenly had a near-death experience right in the middle of an argument. And the experience itself was rather complicated, but in Earth time, it took only a couple of seconds. It's like he hesitated, and then when he started talking again, he was transformed by what he had experienced. So it was the extreme of the emotion of jealousy. So extremes seem to facilitate this. And again, this is my personal opinion, this is not from research. That what happens when we're in extreme conditions is that the normal connection between whatever you want to call our consciousness or soul or whatever word you want to use and our physical structures, which is normally very intertwined while we're alive, in those extreme circumstances that connection gets loosened and the opportunity occurs for the person to have an experience beyond the usual limits of space, time, or identity. So, but here we're focusing really on the ones that occur during during close brushes with death. Excuse me. And you'll notice that the topic is pleasurable Western adult near-death experiences because this is the circumstances or the population that has been studied the most. But later I'll be talking about other populations as well. NDEs, I've come to think of NDEs in terms of three aspects. Now these aspects can occur, they tend to occur in the order that you're going to see them here. But they can occur in any order and they can even overlap. And I'll give you, you'll actually hear an example of that from the gal whose excerpts you'll be hearing. So the first thing that happens is that the person reports that in the midst of this close brush with death, they suddenly just felt absolutely overcome with peace. And they have, and if you ask them, were you in your body or out of your body, they'll go, I don't know. It's like it's not related to the material domain one way or the other, which is why I call it non-material. It's just a non-material, peaceful floating, and a total pervasive peace. And then the next thing that typically happens is that they have the material aspect of the experience. And this is where typically, from a position outside the person's physical body, the person observes the physical world, the material world. And you heard Audrey talk about that being, actually Audrey talked about a phenomenon that I've heard in another drowning NDE by Yvonne Kaysen, having dual consciousness. I was out of my body and I was in my body at the same time. But typically the person really has a sense that they're out of their body and they'll look down and see, gosh, there's somebody laying on the table there that looks like they're in really bad shape and everybody's bustling around them, and then the person goes like, wait a minute, that's me. No, this is me. I must be dead. So it's kind of like that sort of process, but very much a separation. I had one NDEer say, she was talking about watching while a nurse was pulling little shards of glass from her face that had, when her car was impacted, the window, and she just got glass all through her. And she saw this glass being taken out by the nurse. She couldn't feel anything, of course, because she wasn't connected to her body. And she said, yeah, the nurse could have cut off my head and I wouldn't have cared because I knew that was my body, but I just didn't feel connected to it anymore. So typically there's a disconnection, but sometimes there's this dual consciousness like Audrey described. And in this, when people are in this aspect of the experience, perceiving the physical world, they have normal perceptual abilities, like the same as they would have had in their body. So blue looks like blue, and you know, I would recognize you as a person kind of thing. So everything's look pretty normal. But people also have extra abilities. They not only can hear what's being said, they can hear what people are thinking. Like Audrey saying, and Audrey's back there nodding, she could hear this sister praying, even though the sister was praying quietly, silently. They also can both see and see through physical objects, so seeing what's happening in the other room. But another thing that happens is that things happen at the speed of thought. And so if the NDE-er in this state thinks, gosh, I wonder where mom and dad are, boom, they're with mom and dad. Their consciousness moves at the speed of thought. And so, again, things look normal, but there are also additional abilities that the person reports having had. Let me think if there's anything else about the material. I think that those are the main things. I may think of more things later. Then what can happen next, but again, they don't necessarily happen in this order, and not every NDE-er has all aspects. So some can have one, some another, some all three, or in any order. But they kind of tend to occur in this order, is that the person has the experience of moving to trans, or having transmaterial experiences. Transmaterial means things that are not of the material world. So people, you've maybe heard the phrase that people move through a tunnel toward light. That actually represents only a minority of NDEs, but people often do sometime, especially between the transition of the material aspect and the non-material aspect, they experience themselves moving rapidly through some kind of space. It could be a tunnel, some kind of structure, or just through open space. And often it is toward a light. And as the person approaches the light, they have the sense that the light is a being. It's not like a physical light like this, but it's a being. And this being emanates absolute love, absolute knowing and accepting and loving the person, the near-death experiencer. So it's just a very profound experience. In the transmaterial aspect, people also sometimes encounter deceased loved ones. The deceased loved ones sometimes, maybe often, but not always, are if the person is told that they have to go back, that they have to return to physical life because they still have work to do in this incarnation, often it's one of their deceased loved ones that tells them that. And people visit environments that are transmaterial. Sometimes they're like naturalistic environments, but they're just beautiful, and people say that they see colors there that we don't even have on Earth. And they, there might be a field with grass and flowers and trees. Every blade of grass has consciousness. Every flower has consciousness. So, like, different things are happening there than happen on the material level. And sometimes people have experiences of being just out in a void that is absolutely devoid of any objects. So that's another transmaterial kind of environment. So people have a lot of different kinds of experiences in the transmaterial domain. Let's see. And an important thing that usually happens in the transmaterial aspect of the experience is a life review. Usually in the presence of the being of light, the individual reviews and re-experiences typically every moment of their life. And what they also simultaneously experience being on the receiving end of their actions. So if you think about it, near-death experiencers think that we're all going to have this life review when we really die for good, although death is maybe not exactly the right word. When we disembody for good. And that means that they think we'll all have this experience. We all will re-experience this moment. And I will know what it is to be you. And you will know what it is to be me. It's not an empathy. It's a being. The other person is what people say they experience in their life review. Now, if you may be thinking, as I did the first time I read about this, gosh, there's some things in my life that I'm going to be really happy to relive. And there's some things that I'm dreading.